How do you order food for the office these days? How do you make sure it's on time and as ordered? How can you get it individually packaged? How? Easy Cater. When you order on EasyCater.com, the food comes as ordered and on time 98% of the time. And when there's a problem, which is practically never,
thank you for calling Easy Cater.
You can reach someone in about 9 seconds. How do you order 24/7 from more than 80,000 restaurants? How? Easy Cater. Order 24/7 on EasyCater.com.
Odyssey now has hundreds of new exclusive music stations for you to discover your new summer soundtrack.
Get moving with worthy workouts for a cardio sesh fueled by today's top artists.
Hang in with your crew? Throw it back with Picnic Party for old school jams for your cookout.
Or sail away with Odyssey's new yacht rock station, Jugger Yacht.
There are hundreds of new exclusive stations to check out today.
For summer barbecues,
road trips,
or relaxing poolside.
For every mood, every interest, every passion. By Odyssey. Odyssey. Brought to you in part by Macy's and Geico.
It's time to drop the puck. Time for the Nightcap. Your home for news and insider info on your Vegas Golden Knights and the NHL. Let's hear from the goalie. Here's Lindsey Brown.
And welcome to another episode of the Nightcap. Lindsey Brown here, your host always and forever. And we are recording this on the morning of April 2nd. Last night, your Vegas Golden Knights fell at the hands of the Minnesota Wild at T-Mobile Arena in the shootout. And to dissect that game and everything related to the Minnesota Wild and their hunt for the playoff chase this season is Declan Goff again from Score North. He's the producer of the Mackie and Judd Show up there, as well as a co-host of Judd's Hockey Show. Right, Declan? You guys haven't changed anything since I left.
This is true. I've just inherited more work, you know? That's how it works. You know this game, Lynn.
Yes.
They throw more on your plate, and they say, hey, go ahead and make stew out of it, and you try your best. And usually the stew's pretty good, but I'm just saying, sometimes the chef's kind of puts you in a tough spot, but you make the best out of it.
Right. Same position, a cavalcade of responsibilities, and that was definitely present last night in the game against the Minnesota Wild between them and the Vegas Golden Knights. And, you know, these two teams have kind of traded blows all season. And just initially, how did last night's vibe feel to you? It seemed like there's a lot of pace, physicality, intensity. Where are you at with this matchup at this current point in time?
Oh, I love it. I mean, for God's sakes, the Wild have played like the majority of their games against the Ducks and the Sharks. And look, the Ducks are a dumpster fire. I don't think the Sharks are as bad, but they're not fun to watch either right now. Martin Jones is the best. So when they finally play Las Vegas, it's been great. All the games this year have been insane. But last night, I thought was kind of the crown jewel, and it kind of solidifies the fact that it's just got a playoff vibe to it. There was back and forth action. Both Leonard and Talbot were standing on their heads. You could tell that there was an intensity there after, you know, yeah, I mean, the Wild have just been playing these, like, lackluster teams. So when they actually get someone like Vegas, who is very good and very talented, and last time I joined you two a few months ago, I said they're still my team to beat in the Western Conference. I still mostly feel that way. But it was a playoff atmosphere, and I'm guessing you were at the game as well, and you probably were able to feel that. You've been to that arena before, but you could totally tell even from all the way here watching on my laptop in bed since the 9:30 puck drop. And I had to finish the game at midnight in my own bed, and I'm keeping it PG, by the way.
You could still feel
that it was a playoff atmosphere.
Absolutely, and you know, the Wild have always been such a tough matchup for the Vegas Golden Knights. And initially, you know, the Golden Knights in their earlier seasons were all about speed, were all about odd man rushes, which was really on display last night. And the Wild were the bigger, more physical team. But now it seemed like they've reversed roles, where the Wild are the more speedier squad, and the Knights being a little bit more heavy. But in terms of what's going on in this division, I want to kind of dig a little bit deeper on the point that you made in terms of playing who you're playing, because I think the Vegas Golden Knights have a problem with playing down to their competition against the Sharks, against the Kings to an extent, even though they are in the race, against the Ducks and stuff. Do you find that same problem with the Minnesota Wild, where obviously when you play the Golden Knights, when you play the Avalanche, although we'll get into that recent stuff between your team and that team here in a little bit, like, there just seems to be a different level. But are the Wild struggling to kind of put away middling teams as well?
Yeah, sometimes. You know, I'm under the influence that because of the Ducks and the Sharks, and yeah, maybe even the Kings, you can loop all in there, all the California teams. Like
Coyotes.
For sure. Yeah, exactly. The Wild have to get hay against the California teams for sure. They have to be taking points, 2 points every single time, honestly. So when they they lost shootout the other night, whatever, you know, that'll happen. Obviously, they go to again with the Knights yesterday. But sometimes, yes, you can you get like stuck playing against those middling teams. And then when they play a team like Colorado, they get absolutely waxed in back-to-back games. And it didn't really matter that who was in net. It was just an obvious deficiency that the Wild aren't going to be able to keep up with a team like Colorado. And now Colorado's starting to run away with things in the West. We'll see if they're going to be able to hold on to that. But then when you play someone like Vegas and you match up with them very well and you go toe-to-toe, I mean, every single game that they've played against them in, what, four matchups this year have all been very close games. They've all been entertaining games. Already a few of them have gone to overtime. Those are the teams you want to showcase, like, hey, we can actually hang with these teams. But yeah, you can fall into a bad habit where you play those teams like the Ducks and the Sharks. And I don't think the Sharks are as bad as the Ducks. I just think Martin Jones is just absolutely god awful, and they don't even trust Dubnyk. We all, both you and I, both know that from watching him towards the end of his Wild career.
Correct.
That you can absolutely get stuck in playing those middling teams who can kind of give you false hope. Like, I think a lot of Wild fans see them. You know, they were second in the West Division just a couple weeks ago before the Colorado series. Like, well, like, yeah, they're second in the West because they keep beating on the Ducks and Kings, which is what you're supposed to do. But, like, temper your expectations a little bit and lower them because they still got to play the Avs and the Knights. And even if they get there, they're going to have to beat them in the first round, and that's still going to be a tall task.
And let's go back to a couple weeks ago because you kind of already led us there. The Wild were, like, one of the hottest teams in the NHL. They beat the Golden Knights twice at home, including, like, a huge onslaught in that third period, get Marc-Andre Fleury pulled. You beat Arizona 3 in a row, and you're riding high. And then you walk into the Colorado Avalanche's barn and get absolutely waxed. And if I'm not mistaken, in that first game, they put, like, something like 55 shots on it. And we just saw Colorado again, too, and obviously we're all very familiar, and their second, third chance opportunities. They are the best team in this division, I think, in terms of having a nose for the net and always expecting the puck to come to their stick and being able to fire it. But do you think the getting waxed like that has had an effect at all on the Minnesota Wild psyche? Because they've kind of been middling since then. And just when you get dominated like that, especially when these two teams were kind of converging, they're on win streaks at the same time, and then it's so the gap is just so big. Sometimes you're like, oh, damn, maybe we are a little bit ahead of ourselves.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, that was a huge reality check for a lot of different, I think, for the fans, for the franchise, that, look, you can beat up on the Kings and Sharks, and yes, you have a glaring, humongous center problem, but Kaprizov and Fiala have been great this year. Your goaltending has been damn near perfect. So you can steal some games when you don't play very well, but at the same time, you definitely got to, like, realize, like, hey, we're still significantly away from competing on the same level as a team like Colorado and even Vegas, for that matter. Even though the Wild have matched up against Vegas, I think the 30,000-foot view of both teams, you know who's the better team there. I mean, it's pretty obvious between Vegas and Minnesota, but at the same time, they match up well. I think Judd Lee and I disagree. I'm on the factor of, like, you know what? You never know what happens the next year. You don't know. Next year's not a given that you're going to be in this exact position. Like, I'm not asking for the team to go out and trade for Jack Eichel by any means, but just, can you find Sam Bennett? Can you give up a second-round pick? Can you give up a low-tier prospect to at least get some type of center to get Victor Rask off this bleeping top line?
He was out there all the time last night, Declan. I'm like, what year is this? What is happening? Do you think they would kick the tires on Mikael Granlund and see if he would come back? I think he's at 3.5. No.
I want nothing to do with the Wild old guard. This proves the point that we were making when all these trades were coming down, Lindsay, 2 years ago, that you had a chance and it didn't work and you have to blow it up. And yes, was the Nino for Rask trade a bad trade on paper? Of course it was a bad trade on paper. Like, you know, Victor Rask is awful and Nino thrives in Carolina. But out the same breath, the Wild are just as good, and Nino Niederreiter is doing fine in Carolina without – both of them are codependent of each other. Like, they don't need to be with one another to have success. They're both just fine without them. You had to blow up that core.
No, they're hot and cold. They're perfect for each other.
Really, really good. Exactly. So, like, you just had to figure out a way to move on from those guys. So, no, I want nothing to do with a guy Mikael Granlund. But, yes, as I go off of my soapbox there, but find some type of center that you can just – that's just, like, league average. I'm not even asking for, like, a bona fide stud top six,
right,
perennial all-star 60-point guy. Like, you got to find someone who isn't Victor Rask.
Yeah, just don't be a minus. Don't be such an anchor to everything. And that's a, that's one of the underrated elements of NHL hockey, too, is that you could have, you know, two guys on a line that really elevate each other. But if you have one guy who's still – he's being brought along. We didn't expect to see this level of production from Victor Rask. But you think about, well, what if you had someone that was actually competent? How does it look then? And how does that trickle not just in that line but down the entire lineup as well, as you just get more momentum boosts, you score more goals, you have more minutes on different legs. It one guy can really change the entire makeup of the team. It's just really hard to get all those intangibles to line up and then, you know, not disrupt the locker room chemistry that kind of gets laid down throughout the season. I didn't notice Zach Parise out there, and I know that's a commonplace this season, but does he have owies?
He had COVID a couple weeks ago. That's why he officially was he had a positive test for COVID, and then he's been out. But then I feel like, you know, and they haven't like said this, but I feel like he's clear of COVID, and
they're just not playing him.
They just don't want to play him. And also, again, this proves the fact that this team is also just fine without Zach Parise. Now that contract's in like next to immovable. You're gonna have to like swallow some money if you do trade him. There's cap penalties and all that hoopla. But, I mean, he was almost traded to the Isles a year ago at the trade deadline.
Well, and they need a captain type of personality there. Anders Lee went down. So, I mean, if Lou Lamoriello was already kicking the tires, because obviously they have shared history, but I don't know if you can really say, well, who's going to take cross checks in front of the net without him?
Yeah.
That's pretty much all that he brings.
And his game is just, it's not conducive over long-term success. We knew this eventually. This is like basically a ticking time bomb where, he plays a really gritty and admirable style, but like that's not conducive. And for a guy who's had herniated discs in his back within like the last 2 years, like you know that eventually he's really, really going to break down. And unfortunately, like the Wild are stuck with the contract. I would love for them to be able to trade it and get off of it. And if you can go to New York, great. I know, they lost Lee, so they're looking. But also, like, they're not just going to take him for his production. So
No. It'll
be very curious kind of, like, what they end up doing with him. But, he's unnoticeable. And
yeah.
If you can find a way to get off the contract, please do it.
Well, and, you know, 6, 7, 8 years ago, the game still wasn't, you know, in small area game mode where a lot of it was played down low. So he actually could make some hay and differentiate himself. But now that everything is so skill-based that is set up down low, that and – you know, he's not only older, but he doesn't have the skill set or the ability to catch up, to keep up with all of the talent that has been infused, not to just this team, but this league in general. And it's been a very quick descent. I mean, like, I agree with you, Declan. I mean, we talked about this when I was back in Minnesota about how this contract, the length of it, it's not like they're going to be playing their best hockey at the end, but it's been such a quick change. And, you know, I think it's a testament to Bill Guerin and how lucky they are to have him, because you have that pedigree to be able to go up to a guy like that and say, you're not our best option right now. I mean, we kind of had that when Scotty Stevens was the defensive coach for a few years. Remember, Suter was kind of, you know, still in his a-hole phase, but was kind of listening in a way. And then Scotty left, and then it got kind of devolved there for a couple of seasons. But it's just so odd how different this team looks. And you mentioned Cam Talbot. I thought he was excellent last night, you know, especially when he played here in Vegas. It was a month and a half ago or a lifetime ago. He got lit up pretty good. But last night, it seemed like he was holding his edges, that he was challenging well. His weight wasn't falling everywhere. And, you know, he's been kind of on a hot streak as of late. So what's your confidence level in him against these big-time teams? And then also, how are the Wild handling their goaltending rotation? Because Kokkonen's been just as good.
Yeah, I think, you know, he got off to such a good start to start the season. And then I believe he, like, hurt his elbow or wrist, so he was injured. And then there was the COVID thing. So he just got, like, disrupted. And then when he came back, he was fine. Like, he wasn't bad, but he was fine. But then Kapo went on that nice run.
Mm-hmm.
And then now, you know, we all kind of thought, like, I think it's Kapo. Like, if the playoff series started tomorrow, like, it would be Kapo. Well, now it's basically, it's 1A, 1B. Like, I think the 1A is Tam Talbot, and you're riding that hot hand. And the good thing is, I think, too, Dean is doing a very good job at mixing it up. I mean, there's been situations where both guys have started back-to-backs, and that's okay. But, I mean, how many times did Boudreaux and everyone else just run Dubnyk, and, like, the backup never got any time?
Yeah, you can't do that.
To the point where you get to the postseason, everyone gets burnt out. Like, I mean, even in Vegas right now, like Leonard plays well last night. Great. Like that's awesome. And you need him to play well. But then like, you know, Fleury was playing so well earlier in the month that like, well, you can't pull him at the same time. He does need rest. And also it's Robin Leonard as your backup. It's not,
right.
You know, it's not Subban. It's like, it's Robin bleeping Leonard. And so I think with both Talbot and Capo, like they're going to be just fine. I don't expect them to like be at a Vezina level. Like their numbers kind of suggest as of late. At the same time, I trust the goaltending going forward. I really do. I don't think the goaltending is the least of their issues right now. I don't think it's luck. I don't think it's regression. You know, you've been able to see what Cam Talbot has been able to do in person.
Mm.
I don't pretend to be the goalie whisperer. Like, you know, like that I'm going to let you defer to the lateral movements because, like, even just me hearing those words freaks me out. Even though I was a great street hockey goalie, Lindsay, and,
oh.
and a boot hockey runner-up champion in my senior year of high school.
Respect.
Despite my small frame, Lindsay, I came out of that crease and I was ready to make that stay with my ball glove. Okay, I was absolutely ready.
It's not the size of the dog, Declan. It's a fight.
Exactly. So yes, Talbot and Capo have been godsend. And you knew this was going to happen. That the Wild's goaltending was so atrocious last year; it was only going to improve. But I think a lot of people are even surprised how well it's worked out this season.
No, and I'm firmly in that camp. And I think if anything, like the tandem and as you said with Coach, is it Evason or Avison? I always forget.
Evason.
With Evason keeping it, you know, fresh, not just Kokkonen gets one and then Talbot gets one, then you go back and forth. Like, by doing that, I don't think there's going to be a huge regression back to the median here, or the mean, or whatever math term it is, because you know that is not my strong suit. But it just seems like before the bleeding gets really bad, you can switch and then get guys, you know, feeling good again, getting them a new opponent. And if anything, the compressed schedule, this is the one of the very few silver linings of just being able to get the bad taste out of your mouth if you do lose a bad game or have a bad performance. Because, you know, as you mentioned, Fleury has been on a Vezina level all season, but his last few starts have not been there. Like, you can just tell that either the legs and just kind of the fatigue are either catching up with him, or that he's being disrupted by the fact that he was starting so much, he was vibing, and then now that Leonard is back and healthy and playing well, that he has to kind of figure out his pacing a little bit better. And it's something that the Vegas Golden Knights, you know, like the Minnesota Wild, have relied upon. They're not anywhere without their goaltending. Like, I think they're, you know, middling playoff team if they didn't get that type of streak from Fleury, because I just don't think they're playing super well. And this is the first time that they've lost two straight technically this season, so it's a big-time tilt tomorrow night. Again against the Wild. And one of the players that I noticed a lot for the Wild last night, other than Kaprizov, you know, it's just it's magnetic, Declan. It really is. But Jordan Greenway, I mean, other than the fact that his jersey numbers look like they're the small ones, like, you know, when you have too big of a jersey and the numbers don't fit, like, it just, he's that big of a human. But he had over 19 minutes of ice time last night. This is a guy who is a year and a half, maybe two seasons removed, being in the AHL, being told that you're not giving enough, you're not sacrificing enough, you're not working hard enough. And it seems like this guy's not only found a way to take it to another level, but like build on himself in the game. So what are you seeing with him, and what do you attribute all of his improvement and his importance to this team this season?
Yeah, he's been probably the biggest surprise in a good way for the Wild this season, just because his numbers show it. He's being trusted in big situations. I mean, it's really too bad Foligno got hurt, who's supposed to be back here, I think, pretty in the next week or so. Because the line with Greenway, Ek, and Foligno was the team's best line. And that team, all things considered, all of them remaining healthy, are going to be the team that shuts down an opposing top line in a postseason series. But I think with Greenway's, like, unlockingness, if you will, for the lack of better words, I think it was all Guerin. I think Bill Guerin sat him down and basically kind of told him, like, who do you want to be, dude? Like, do you want to be a big body? Because, I mean, and just kind of coast around and
right.
and
you have everything.
Player,
you have everything.
You can be Charlie Coyle if you want. Like, if you want to play and you don't want to, like, and you don't want to focus on scoring goals and using your body to its fullest potential, you can do that. There's guys like that exist in the NHL all over the place. Or do you want to fulfill, like, what people think of you? You're a second round pick. You were a stud at Boston. You were really good in the World Juniors tournament. Do you want to unlock that potential? And I think Guerin really sat him down and got it. That's just totally reckless speculation, as I love to do.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I think it was Guerin having a conversation with him of who do you want to be, and then also Dean Evason trusting him to also kind of pair him with Joel Eriksson Ek, who's also a very big pest and someone who's
God, he's a little a-hole out there, Declan.
Yeah.
Oh, he just jaws. I can just see, like, you, where it's a guy who gets, you know, 2-3 inches from your nose and be like, I'm not touching you. Like, he has that type of vibe for me. It would drive me nuts.
He doesn't he doesn't have like the natural skill set of Mikko Koivu, but he has diet Mikko Koivu to him in his prime when you can tell he's a penalty killer. You hate playing against him. He's going to piss you off. And that's where I told Judd too at the preseason that I thought he was going to start scoring some goals, not because he has like this insane natural ability to find goals, but like he works so hard and he puts himself in situations that
right place,
he'll
right
never
time
score a highlight reel goal, but he mm-hmm. like he's up to double digit goals.
Right.
And no one saw that coming. So is he going to be a perennial like Brock Besser kind of guy, and everyone kind of prepares them because they were drafted very close. The Wild could have had Besser, but they went with Ek. Like, of course, everyone's going to compare the two. And I think even if you want to, you know, put him in a draft, Besser still gets taken over Joel Eriksson Ek. But Joel Eriksson Ek can also still be a very important piece for this team. And when this team has no center depth, I mean, he is their best center. He's their best center right now, bar none. And it's not, it's a little bit by default, but also because he's been able to take his game to the next level. And he's been great. Him and Greenway have just really stepped up this year, because we saw those young players, the same thing we were talking about earlier with Coyle and Nino and Zucker and Granlund. Like, yes, they took one step forward, but then they never took another one. They just plateaued right there.
Right.
And you love seeing that Greenway and Ek have taken that first next step.
No, there has clearly been a shift, and I really like that you're making the comparison to that previous young crop of guys with Coyle, with Granlund, with Zucker and stuff, because I agree. I think they were on the same path, but what they didn't get was a leveling up from the team itself. They weren't able to get over the hump in the playoffs. There wasn't like a transcendental talent infused into their roster like Kaprizov, where all of a sudden you're not only having a guy that's scoring goals, you're having a guy that's bringing belief into you, like, oh my God, we can do this here. Like, what can I do with him? What can they do with him? And I really think between Kaprizov and then what Bill Guerin has done, because that's the common denominator I believe in all of this, is this complete transformation of this team. Even though you do have some players that are still there, it's just, it seems like there's a mindset difference, and it's Guerin, it's Avison, it's I think Foligno, like everybody kind of getting behind the right guys instead of being like, well, we got to do what Zach's doing, or we got to do what Suter's doing, or we got to do, you know, they're following themselves more than following others. And I think that bodes really well for them, not just this season in which they're outperforming expectations, but it clearly expedites their kind of plan to rebuild. We were saying tear it down to the studs, and I think they kind of did that and got lucky. And but that's sometimes all that you need. That it's just we haven't gotten those bounces, and we haven't hit in the draft until this year. And so I'm very excited for this team, and I know the Vegas Golden Knights are not excited to play them again tomorrow night. But what do you think in terms of adjustments that are going to be made tomorrow night? Because now we're getting in the stretch of the season. We're seeing some differences between game, the first game being played in a series and a second game being played in the series. Do you think it tightens up more, or do you think it opens up? Because we've kind of seen both from in the matchups between these two this season.
Right. I'm going to go that leans that it opens up. You know, like both goalies stood on their heads for the entire game last night. And I don't know if that'll happen again. I'm curious if he goes with Kapo. I'm curious if he stays with Talbot. But also, you know, like Kaprizov last night played like 25, 24 minutes and like four more minutes than any other forward. Now, that's not going to be something he does every night, but at the same time, I think it shows that they trust Kaprizov, because the evidence is right there in front of you, the eye test, the analytics, everything you want to point out, he hits it on. But you can't run him into a situation where you're running him out there for 25 minutes and juggling him around all over the place. Him and Fiala are Batman and Robin, for the lack of a better word. They really are. They're carrying the team. And when you have two guys like that and you get stellar goaltending, it can really pay dividends. But I think what I'm scared of is eventually, like, the Knights being the sleeping giant who eventually wakes up. Because, like I said, over the 30,000-foot view, the Knights are deeper, they're better, they are a better team. For whatever reason, the Wild give them fits. At the same time, I'm more worried that, like, the Knights pull an avalanche on them, for the lack of a better word, and eventually wake up and just absolutely go to town. Because we haven't seen basically Vegas dominate a game yet, I think. Unless I'm blanking on one of them. I think all the games have just been super, super close. They've been either tied, or there's been lead changes, there's been overtime. So, like, I'm waiting for them to kind of basically wake up and throttle the Wild and say, like, no, we are the better team. But, like, maybe that is. It's Dean's pulling the right strings here. I don't know. I don't know what it is. I mean, I don't know if it's just the Knights underestimating them. I don't know if it's them not living up to their full potential. But, yeah, I kind of see the floodgates opening up a little bit on Saturday, and I'm curious to see who comes out on top.
Yeah, I think the Wild, for the most part, were in the driver's seat and very much the aggressors last night. I think the Knights will definitely try to adjust some of their breakouts because the Wild were pinching down so hard because they the Knights love going up the wall, Declan. We love going up the wall, and we love going to the outlet pass, and we'll bump and go through the neutral zone. And it's just like, if you have a couple of aggressive guys forechecking, all you got to do is disrupt and create chaos and then pick up the garbage at the end. And that was a lot what I was seeing last night. And that's kind of what the Knights are. It's really hard for them to make adjustments in game, and I think that's one of their biggest downfalls, especially against teams that are up to their level, like the Minnesota Wild, like the Colorado Avalanche, just because it's just hard to pivot when you're trying to play your high level game, and then all of a sudden, well, they took away our option A. Well, you got to be able to play an option, but this is what it is, and so you got to start practicing that and getting that implemented. But they had a short bench last night. I don't know what the hell they're gonna be doing for it tomorrow because it's all like salary cap and Stevenson got suspended. It's all this other BS, but you know, it's just straight up. You gotta convert on your power play, which the Wild did for once last night, and scoring in the shootout. So there's a lot of areas in which both teams can improve. And like you said, I just hope that there's a different level that these teams can bring because it does already feel like playoffs. But in terms of somebody actually taking the throttle and being like, let's go, nobody's done it yet. And both teams are very much capable, my friend.
Totally, totally, yeah. I mean, I think I'd be curious to see, you know, the Avalanche and Knights in a playoff series. That'd be fun. You know, mm-hmm. I think the Wild would just get absolutely waxed by Colorado, but I think it'd be a 7-game series against Vegas. If they line up against Vegas in a best of 7, I think it's going 7.
Yeah.
I think it'd be a ton of fun. And I'm curious if the Wild can keep this up. You know, they were one of the hottest teams in the league going back to like basically the last six weeks. They still are top 5 in most all major categories. You know, some aggression might come, but I do this thing. They're clearly making the playoffs. I think they're like at a 90% chance to make the postseason. It's just, who are they going to line up against? Are you going to get Vegas or are you going to get Colorado? And I think if you're the Wild fans and if you're the Wild, you probably definitely want Vegas. You probably want nothing to do with Colorado.
Seeding matters, even at the high school dances when you get picked first, and all of a sudden it's a different type of team, it's a different type of dance partner, and I agree. I think there's going to be a lot of shared history between these two squads in the coming months, and I appreciate you taking some time today to talk to us about the series right now. I know that you are a busy man, and that it is this season is unlike any other. There's no breathing room, Declan. There's none.
There is not. Judd's wrapping up a podcast right now. We're going to talk Wild here in another 15 minutes. The content beast, as you know, Lindsay,
yeah,
never sleeps. And even on a Friday when I want to get home and crack some seltzers and just sit on my couch and watch hockey, nope. Can't even do that yet.
The old routine. And so before I let you go, why don't you plug that podcast just in case anybody is down here looking for a deeper dive on the Minnesota Wild or anything that you are involved with, my friend.
Absolutely. Yeah, we're Judd's Hockey Show, and you can find us on Apple, Spotify. ScoreNorth.com is our home. And then you can also subscribe to our YouTube channel. That's youtube.com/ScoreNorthMN. We post Wild conversations. I dare I say some of the best Wild conversations on the YouTube. So if you like watching a couple of visual dudes who are at Faces for Radio talk puck, we are on YouTube. ScoreNorthMN, give us a subscribe. We will gladly fulfill your Wild hockey needs.
You guys are my favorites. I love you and I miss you. And I wish nothing but the best. And say hi to Judley and to Mackie. It's been a while. It has been a while. But thank you, Declan, and I hope to talk to you soon, dude.
All right. Thanks, Lynn. Appreciate you.
Bye. That was Declan Goff from Score North. He covers the Minnesota Wild for them, co-produces a daily sports show up there as well, and one of my former co-workers. It's always good to catch up with him, get the lowdown on the Minnesota Wild, because I do think that they are going to be one of the biggest thorns in the shoes, or at least the boots of the coat of armor for your Vegas Golden Knights. But we'll be back next week. I think we have Catherine Silverman that's going to be talking with us about the Arizona Coyotes and their middling season so far. But thank you so much for tuning in this week, and we'll talk to you soon. Bye.
Why is there a harbor seal walking around the office?
Oh, that's our new CEO.
Come again?
Well, apparently they didn't order through Easy Cater for the board meeting, and when the food didn't arrive, they kind of lost focus. Next thing you know?
We have a seal as our CEO. Did I say something wrong?
No, she just wants a mackerel. Here you go.
Bad ideas happen when there's no food for the meeting. So make sure it's on time and as ordered from more than 80,000 restaurants. Now, Easy Cater.
Thank you. I just got promoted.
Order 24/7 on EasyCater.com.
Dealing with adversity and finding ways to unify and overcome it will always be part of our future. The new season of Hope Through History, a documentary podcast presentation from C13 Originals in association with the History Channel. Written and narrated by me, John Meacham, features moments in our nation's past when we faced challenges as a country and as a world. Listen and follow Season 2 of Hope Through History, available now wherever you get your podcasts.